speaker is from Professor Zhang from NCKU, and his presentation is processing and calibration in the Triton GNSSR receiver. Please.
Good morning and good evening. My name is Ji-Qin Zhang from the Department of Electrical Engineering, National Cheng Kung University, Taiwan. I would like to present processing and calibration in the Triton GNSSR receiver. And this presentation is follow NSPO presentation about the Triton machine. But I will emphasize on the development and all the activity related to the GNSSR receiver, which is a primary payload for the Triton mission. The content of the presentation is as follows. I will briefly introduce the presentation, and the presentation will essentially contain two parts. One is Triton GNSSR payload about the specification and status. And then I will move forward to talk about some unique or some difference between the GNSSR receiver of Triton mission and other existing mission. So we'll talk about the multi-GNSS reflectometry and some of the activity and research work that's being conducted at NCKU together with NSPO. Okay. And also in this presentation, you can see my photo just in case you can recognize it. When we talk about the GNSS application in space mission, we can characterize this kind of mission into three classes. One is for PNT, that means for the position, navigation, and timing services. And this kind of mission typically use a GNSS receiver that try to receive and process broadcast GNSS signal to determine the position, velocity, and time of the information. And this is mainly beneficial for space mission in terms of precise orbit determination and many other applications. But we also realize that we can utilize GNSS signal for some other scientific mission, notably for radio occultation mission and reflectometry mission. In the radio occultation mission, typically the signal that we receive from the GNSS satellite are reflected signals. So that means the single propagation path may go through the ionosphere or atmosphere. So that we could then, based on the observation, deduce the information associated with the ionosphere and troposphere and so forth. We could also utilize the reflectometry technology, that means the GNSS signal broadcast from the satellites may reflect it or scatter from the Earth. And then if we are able to receive and process the reflect signal or scatter signal, we will then be able to deduce certain information about the surface of Earth for remote sensing application. And this is typically termed as a GNSSR. In Taiwan space mission, we have been looking for this kind of application, that's including PNT application, R application, R application. In the PNT application, the upcoming Formosa 8 mission will utilize the self-development GNSS receiver and to determine the position, velocity, and time. And also, most of you may be familiar with the Formosa 3 and 7 mission, and those are the mission that explore the radio occultation principle and have been utilized in many different kind of scientific mission for the probing of the ionosphere and atmosphere. And the topics that we'll be talking today will then be reflected to a reflectometry application. And this, in Taiwan space program, is termed as a Triton mission. Triton mission try to utilize the GNSSR and to understand or try to measure, for example, the ocean wind speed and other relevant information. And in the previous talk from Dr. Chai, he have talk about some of this kind of mission already. We can also take a look at how the overall strategic plan for Taiwan's NEAT space program and associated some universities, including NCKU. And this talk about some of the payload for this GNSS related remote sensing and scientific application. And between NCKU and NSPO, we have been looking into the development of this many fundamental and enabling technology, try to develop the receiver. So we have been looking at space-borne GNSS PNT receiver, and this will be realized in the Formosa 8 mission and some other CubeSat program. And in this talk, I'll talk about GNSSR receiver. And this receiver, in our understanding, is technology readiness level is 6, and we had to do a lot of verification and validation kind of task through flight tests, but we're gonna to eventually verify it in the Triton mission. And in the build graph, you'll see the prototype and the flight model as well as the antenna. And in the meantime, we are also looking at the development of some GNSSRO receiver technology. So that's we try to compile this kind of technology together, because some of the technology or core technology are related. And we hope that this kind of develop can then support the scientific community to do further scientific exploration. The Triton mission is a GNSSR mission, and the GNSSR receiver is 100 net in Taiwan. That means we design, manufacture, and test the receiver in Taiwan. And so in this build graph, you'll see the overall payload system. That means the GNSS receiver is will be installed in the Triton satellite, and it's like an interface with the power control unit to supply the power from the satellite, and also it's an interface between the onboard computer of the Triton satellite. So that's also information exchange between the satellite bus and the payload receiver. And for the receiver, it's contain two antenna. One is Zenith antenna, another is a Nadir antenna. And those will then collect direct line of sight GNSSR signal, as well as reflected or scattered GNSS signal, and then do all the processing. And if we compare this Triton GNSSR receiver with the Cygnus receiver, which have also been discussed today, we could say that there's some similarity, as I will mention later on, but please remember there's also certain differences. And these differences, in my view, are as follows. One, we could provide more DDM, direct Doppler map, in this Triton GNSSR receiver. And more precisely, existing Cygnus GNSSR receiver can provide 4 DDM per second. And we are now able to provide 8 DDM per second. Second, the Triton GNSSR receiver is a dual frequency receiver. So it can process the L1 signal in real time, and it also have the capability to store L2 signal sample. So that means we will then be able to do, or at least potentially have the capability to do some additional analysis. The third difference is that we look into the utilization of some additional GNSS satellite signal, because in addition to GPS, there are also Galileo signal and QZSS signal. Galileo is from European, and QZS is a Japanese regional navigation satellite system. And because these signals, they are essentially compatible, so our receiver can receive and process the reflection signal through this kind of satellite. And definitely that's increase the opportunity for all the scientific investigation. The broader diagram of the system is depicted in this view graph, and as mentioned, this TNSS receiver contains two antenna, one Zenix antenna that try to receive the direct line of sight signal from the GNSS satellite, and those information definitely are needed, for example, to determine the position, velocity, and time. And also there is one nadir antenna, and this particular nadir antenna is an A element high gain antenna, and the peak gain can be up to 14 dBi. And because the reflect signal is essentially mainly weak, so we need some additional antenna gain together with good RF processing, and could enhance the signal quality. And although this signal goes through the RF front end, radio frequency front end, and this RFFE essentially will then filter, amplify the signal, and then do all the analog to digital conversion. And the outcome of this RFFE are digital sample. And this digital sample will then send it to the navigation units. This navigation unit is a GNSS receiver that's process a direct line of sight signal, and this will then be able to track the incoming signal, determine the position and time. And the major function for GNSS operation is in this science unit, and it could then extract, for example, the direct line of sight signal, as well as, more importantly, the reflect signal, and then do all the computation to provide the DDM. And it's also have the capability to store the data for further investigation. And the operation of this science unit may depend on the navigation units, because the signals are coming from the same satellite. And particularly, this navigation unit is a heritage of NSPO GPS receiver. And but for the science unit, that's a new design, because we're based on the Zinc 7000 series SoC, and then develop all the firmware, software, FPGA, and all the interface. And then we also had to make sure that it could successfully interface with the Triton bus. Okay. The main specification of the Triton GNSSR receiver are as follows. I will not try to read it, but I highlight some of the key figures so that you can observe that in red color. That's including the DDM resolution is 128 by 64 in co-phase and in frequency band. And it's in the original specification, we call for 4 DDM per second. But now we are able to, and the receiver have been able to perform 8 DDM per second currently. And the GNSSR receiver will process and record the direct line of sight and reflected GPS, QGS, and carrier signal in L1 and L2 band. Okay, and definitely we'll talk about some calibration and retrieval issue there. Okay, so all the capability, all the specification are as depicted in this big graph. About the development of this, because the specification had been set up many early, so in the development process, we just refer to a specification and try to realize all the functionality, and then to achieve all the related performance. And this build graph show the development process. And as you can see, it's a BG chart. I mean, it takes some time for us to develop the system, that's including the antenna, receiver, all the software, hardware, and to conduct all the tests. So the work begin as 2014. And at that time, that we define the mission and do all the analysis, and also start the work to develop certain key technology, that's including using FPGA to realize the DDM computation and so forth. And in 2015, that's where I was able to develop the prototype and do all some ground tests. And in 2016, that's where we begin the flight tests. And then definitely we come up with certain engineering model to do all the relevant tests. And in this engineering model that we've been able to verify all the specification, as mentioned in the previous charts, and all the function and all the performance have been met there. Okay. And after that, we continue improving our model, that's including some software upgrade as well as our function enhancement of certain function. And also the flight model have been manufactured and do all the tests, that's including the EMI, EMC tests, including the integration tests integrated into the satellite, internal flight set, and also eventually to the bus system. So there's a certain work that's majorly conducted at NSPO try to develop and test the flight model. But in terms of function and performance, we also conduct a serial test work. That's we utilize the aircraft and UAV to do all the tests. And so with that, we come a long way, and we hope that in 2022, the satellite can be successful launch and the payload can successfully operate it. So, great deal of work have been devoted to the flight test, because the system model, the engineering model, have been manufactured in 2016. But we will hope that the data that we gather, the processing algorithm that we develop, can be verified and validated. Okay, so we use the AIDC extra flight vehicle as well as the UAB to do some tests. Typically, this kind of test try to verify the functionality of the GNSS receiver. And also we try to check the function of the EGSE. And in this series of tests that we do, have certain modification, try to enhance our software and then to make sure that the firmware is more robust and so forth. And we have been also do some tests together with some buoy data correlation, so that we try to verify the data for eventually wind speed retrieval. Okay, so you can see the UAB here, and this is an aircraft. So the typically that's the instrument is installed in the pylon, and so that we can do the observation. These are the EGSE interface program. And these are show the test flight routes of one of the flight tests. So this is a Taiwan Island. So we've been circulating Taiwan Island for in one particular flight. And these are the flight routes in one of the UAB tests. So this is a coastal ocean crosshair. And so we have to do certain tests there. In the typical mission, that's definitely we can use this diagram to show the functionality. So that means the aircraft can take off from the airport, and we could then observe all the DDN information, and we could record that, and then on the aircraft that we can then check the status of all the information. So the DDN being collected and then been archived, so we could then not only monitor the performance in real time, but also we could then retrieve the data for further analysis. And we have been doing this in some of the flight tests. And I believe Dr. Chai also mentioned some of the flight tests in his presentation. So about the status of the GNSSR payload, I would say that all the requirement and specification have been compiled and through the test. And in this two figure that's in the also appear in the NSPO website, you can see not only for DDM, but also APDDM. And this has been tested in some of the flight tests. And this will be the configuration that we got to use in the Triton mission. So we will then come up with ADDM per second kind of data. And about the satellite selection, definitely the survey can manage all the effectiveness of the satellite and based on the orbit of the satellite that we could then select, for example, the high elevation satellite for DDM processing. So having update about the status of GNSSR receiver, then would I then move forward to talk about some unique feature of this Triton GNSSR receiver. So in our design, definitely we see also see certain change in the development of GNSS satellite. For example, nowadays we understand that there are more than 100 GNSS satellites that can be utilized for position navigation and timing, and definitely this satellite can then also be utilized for remote sensing, for example, reflectometry. And given that our payload had been developed based on the L1 in principle for real-time processing and L2 for post-processing purpose, that's definitely we look into the real-time capability. So certain L1 band signal that we have been included into our GNSSR payload, that's including the GNSS satellite of GPS, Galileo, and QGSS. So now we are talking about the multi-GNS kind of GNSSR receiver. And also, as there's one Xenix antenna, another Nadir antenna. So we process direct line of sight signal and reflect signal on board the payload. We look into their relationship. That means we look into the reflect signal versus direct line of sight signal waveform. And we come up with a channel response model, try to relate these two signals. And a benefit of this kind of channel response model is it's less sensitive to the transmitted power of the GNSS satellite. And because we understand that in the synchronous mission, the transmitted power of the GPS satellite have certain impact on the retrieval results. And we look into the channel response model and realize that it could be less sensitive to the transmitted power. So we look into this kind of opportunity. So if you ask to understand the Triton GNSSR receiver payload, I would say these two characteristics are unique in comparison with synchronous mission. So I'll talk about this in the following. As mentioned, that we're able to receive GPS, Galileo, and QGS satellite signal. And so definitely we'll look into what's the common between those and what are the difference, because if there's a lot of commonality, then definitely our receiver or our payload will then be able to process those. But if there are certain differences, then we may need to modify the firmware and software that, and try to accommodate the differences. And this table summarizes the differences there. That's including the GPS, Galileo, and QGSS. Essentially, we could say that there are four single components that may be of interest. One is L1C echo, okay. Another is L1C, and both GPS and QGS, they are capable of broadcasting L1CA and L1C signal. But QGS have been realized that L1C signal have been broadcasting the L1C signal, but it's only had to wait for the GPS-3 that are capable to broadcast L1C. For Galileo signal, it's broadcasting E1 signal, and QGS is also a single component called L1S. And all these chipping rate are the same, and the code lengths are different. So the code length different, that means in the receiver that you have to implement your code generator accordingly. And the main difference definitely is modulation, because some of this signal are BPSK modulated, some are bug modulated binary offset carrier modulation, and so you see certain differences there. So one benefit of combining different kind of GNSS data, I think, for example, combining GPS Galileo and QGIS, is you will then be able to observe more satellite. And for GNSS, is those high elevation satellite signal, that's maybe more applicable, because even we have a high gain antenna in the zenith, but in the nadir direction, but the beamwidth is restricted. So that's when we try to look for high elevation observation. And in this diagram, you'll see a typical flight path, and you can also see the sky plots as one of the particular points. And if we are able to receive GPS, Galileo, and QGIS satellite signal, you'll see the increase of the observation point at a high elevation region. In this typical sky plot, the center is for the zenith direction there, but then so you see a lot of high elevation satellite in this particular observation. So that will be mainly useful for us in the later data processing stage. As mentioned, GPS, Galileo, and QGIS signal, they are different in terms of this kind of modulation. Essentially, we can classify this into BPSK and BOC modulation, although in detail, lots of different bug modulation have been realized, but because our front end bandwidth are somehow limited, so we talk about the BOC, or essentially BOC11 kind of configuration. And the main difference between the BPSK and BOC in the signal processing is in the BPSK modulation, for example, GPSL1CA call, you will see the triangular shape of the correlation function. But if you are using BOC kind of modulation, you will see different kind of shape of the autocorrelation function. So, but because all the GNSS are processed and they rely on non-coherent integration to the processing, so what we'll be looking at is the square of the autocorrelation function. So that's means if you use a BPSK, you'll see one peak, but use the BOC modulation, you'll see one major peak, but also you'll see two side lobes. And these two side lobes definitely is one of the main characteristics of this BOC modulation. But what's happened if we have this kind of waveform and it's under reflection? That means if we try to look into the reflected signal and then see this kind of waveform. For BPSK, the original shape may be like this, but through the reflection or the scattering, you may see the change of the peak value or amplitude modes can be changed, and also you will see certain spread in the trailing edge. And for BOC modulation, it undergo similar effect, but you will see certain change in this peak as well as a certain variation in the side lobe. But one characteristic is as follows. That means if you compare this value, that you'll see the major main lobe is decreasing, the leading side lobe is decreasing, but the trailing side lobe may be increasing. Okay, and you will also see the spread there. So if you compare these two diagrams, you will then observe that there are more future can be observed for BOC signal because due to the characteristic of the side lobe. Okay. But definitely, if we want to explore this, we need a high resolution in the, for example, code delay direction. So with this observation, definitely we come up with a so-called channel response model, try to process the direct line of sight signal and the reflected or scattered signal at the same time. So essentially, a signal coming from the GPS or GNSS satellite can go through the direct line of sight dynamic, and then we can then observe that as Y direct. But through the reflection channel, definitely is made through the scattering, but we will then be able to observe the Y reflected. So the purpose of the channel response model is try to compare the Y direct and the Y reflect signal. And we will try to compare those, and hopefully that we can then extract a certain parameter through this kind of comparison. And one thing as noted, that this kind of comparison will then be not sensitive to the change of the power of the transmitted power, because any change there will then be equally affected in these two components. So the channel response plays a role that's to reflect signal with respect to a direct signal. So if we go back to what we have been saying, that's when we have been able to observe the direct components, which is related to the correlation function square. And through the channel model, we try to come up with the relationship so that it may be related to the direct signal through the channel response function. This channel response function, if we think about, is a linear system. And definitely, we can use a convolutional integral to reflect that. So that means if we are able to calculate this channel response function or model, then we will then be able to deduce certain parameter associated with the reflection dynamics. And then that's maybe reflected to the roughness, wind speed, and some other parameters. So definitely, we can look into a more complicated channel response model. But we start with the first order model. If we regard this as a first order model, we can then consider its impulse response or the transfer function, which is the Laplace transform of the impulse response. And to check whether this model is applicable, definitely we do some simulation. And just to figure out simulation result, that means we could then come up with an autocorrelation function square, and we apply different kind of parameters that include a change of the gain V and the delay between the direct line of sense signal and then the reflect signal, which is gamma, and also parameters A that's related to the time constant. If we change the parameter A, that you will see the spread of this trailing edge and all the phenomena that we discussed about the change of the peak value and the spread of the waveform can be observed there. And definitely in these two figures, we didn't include the effect of B, but you can also imagine that the B will then be able to change the magnitude. So you could see the model can reflect all the behavior that we have observed in the previous figure. But how good are this model? Because we have been conducting some flight tests, so we've been able to gather a lot of direct line of sight and reflect signal based on the flight test data. So we do the verification. So in this diagram, you'll see that we can obtain the direct line of sight single component and the reflect signal component in the same flight test at the same location with respect to the same satellite there. And we somehow normalize it so that you can see clearly. And if we apply the model, then you'll see the match there. And this model is, we obtain the direct line of signal and then pass through the transfer function, and then we can construct the reflect signal. So you can see that they match pretty well. And similarly, that can be also be observed for BOC component there. So in this BOC component, we use a Galerio signal there. So these are the two curves are the low measurement from the BOC waveform there. But then based on the blue curve or the direct line of sight component, we apply the model, and then we could then do many nice reconstruction. And we check different kind of model, for example, because in the previous diagram we check about first order model, definitely we look in some other model. And you can see this kind of model, definitely if you increase the model, you could then reduce the error. But essentially, the first order model appear to be applicable in this kind of model matching. So that means we can then come up with this kind of channel-based channel response model to reflect the direct line of sight component and reflected component. And how are we going to utilize this kind of model? Because we have been able to find this kind of channel response model in this, but as we have mentioned, that's this kind of model applicable to BPSK and also to BOC signal. So we do one more step, that's why to relate all everything together. That means if you look into our GNSSR payload, that's we've been able to process direct line of sight signal and reflected signal. We've been able to process BPSK and BOC signal. So we have the information of all this, okay? So with that, we can establish a model that try to relate the BPSK and BOC kind of module there. And with this, we could then come up with a cumulative diagram. And this is a very good information if you are trying to verify our signal, and it also reveals certain information for us to do, for example, the calibration, because all the signal can be obtained and then they could check with respect to each other. So we did one more experiment or adventure, because in Asian Pacific region, we've been able to receive QZSS signal, and definitely GPS-3 satellite also be able to transmit L1C signal. And if you compare L1CA and L1C, definitely one L1CA is a BPSK modulated signal, and L1C is a bug modulated signal, and they all come from the same satellite. So that's when we can then apply the cumulative diagram that we have mentioned in the previous diagram, try to do the comparison and correlation. And these are the summary results we process based on the L1C signal and L1CA signal from the QZS, etc. And you'll see this kind of data, we've been able to do the reconstruction or do the cell consistency check. This definitely has some impact in the calibration, and this diagram shows some of the calibration tasks that we have been conducting in the Triton GNSSR receiver. In this diagram, the right hand part essentially that we refer to the signal DDM calibration procedure. So that means we kept low DDM and satellite metadata and some other input data, and we do the needed temperature measurement, try to come up with a IF chain, and then we then measure the signal and noise, and then do all the calibration. And one missing point is in the Triton GNSSR, we do not have breakbody temperature measurement. So we simplify the procedure developed by Scott a little, but essentially we implement this, and that will be utilized for additional for further level one and level two kind of processing. But in this presentation, I mentioned this. So that means we have been implementing this direct line of sight of data, and then we explore the channel response analysis kind of information. And we hope this kind of information can then enrich the calibration procedure to come up with a better calibrated DDM. And also we have been looking at the utilize of this kind of channel model data, for example, the time constant that we mentioned. We try to relate that particular parameter with, for example, the wind speed, and that may also come up with certain data that can be useful for remote sensing. So in this presentation, I talk about the Triton GNSSR payload, including the requirement specification and all the flight tests. And I also talk about some unique feature, and more importantly, in this Triton GNSSR receiver, we combine multi-GNSS kind of scenario, and then we also propose a channel response model. And we will hope that this could then augment our GNSSR payload capability in terms of the processing all different kind of GNSS satellite, and we would hope that this kind of research can also be beneficial to ensure the quality in terms of the better calibration result, as well as more opportunity for eventually data retrieval and remote sensing. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Zhang. Now we open for questions.
This is for the last speaker. I'm curious about what the plans are for measuring the strength of the direct signal with the navigation receiver. Is that part of your calibration plan? I was asking about the measurement of the signal strength for the direct signal.
Yes, as I replied, that's indeed that a navigation receiver can get a C over N, and then that could be a reference. But when our doing this, we using the recall mode, so that we can download all the low data from the Zenix antenna and Nadir antenna. So we could do certain post-processing to verify that.
Does the navigation receiver use automatic gain control to state?
Well, that's mode can be disabled. Okay, so we have a control mode to change the gain of the front end. That's all the, so there's a gain control mode and there's a AGC mode. But when we're doing that, we fix the gain so that we could deduce all the parameters.
Right. We use the automatic gain control for the first 1.5 years with Cygnus until we realized how serious this problem was. And then we changed to a fixed gain. And now the calibration is much more stable.
Okay, thank you for that.
Any question else? Okay, if there's no any question else, I should hand over the meeting to Professor Yang.
Yeah, thank you.